You've got the cape.
What have you done with the cow?
She ran away.
What?
Never even reached home. I've been looking for her all night.
How could you?
Well, she might just as easily have run away from you.
Yeah, but she didn't.
Yeah, but she might have
but
done.
But she didn't.
But she might
but
have
she
done.
She didn't!
Cares! Cow's gone. Get it back. Get it back.
You know, we were just about to do that, but here, in the meantime...
Get away from me with that, you fool! I can't touch it, remember?
By midnight tomorrow, bring me the items, or that child you wish for will never see the light of day!
Don't like that woman.
That's a clip from Into the Woods, and I'm delighted to say we've been joined by Meryl Streep. Hello, Meryl. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
How are you?
Very well.
And you haven't been on the show since 2008.
So you said to me earlier.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Shocked.
Which was Doubt, which is another fabulous film. Anyway, I've just been to see Into the Woods, and I have all these songs running through my head. What an extraordinary musical. Where to start? Tell us about it.
Blah, 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 blah. Well, it's
that's what I'm thinking.
It's a Stephen Sondheim, very well loved musical in the United States. I don't know how well it's known here, but I do know that Imelda, my friend Staunton, was played, I think, the baker's wife in a production here. I don't know how long it ran, but it's something that they've been trying to adapt to a film for a long time. But its moment just met the times, I guess, and it all came together.
Yes. I mean, it is a very, very long time. So it was winning awards in 1987.
Yes.
And I was reading that in one read-through, it was Goldie Hawn and Robin Williams who were sitting through. So why has it, do you know why it's taken so long to get to the movie stage?
Well, I think for a long time, studios were nervous of musicals. I'm not really sure why, because it's our great national art form, I think, the American musical. And I think, but they're expensive to make, although this one really was very economically produced,
was
I
it?
Have to say, yes. Disney's also produced a Cinderella that Ken Branagh has directed, and they had, I believe, ten more millions of dollars than we did to make theirs, and they didn't have any music. So this was a...
he's quite a spendthrift.
He's
Ken Branagh.
Well, I guess he's,
he's
the queen of Hollywood or something. He can get whatever he wants. But we struggled. But the film is every cent of beauty that you can buy is on the screen, I think. And Sondheim was happy, and that made me the happiest of all, that he was thrilled with this production.
So for people who don't know the story, it's like it's a combination of a whole number of fairy tales all brought together.
Yes, it's sort of fairy tales meets reality head on. And so it's the story of a lot of different Cinderella and Rapunzel and a made-up story about a baker and his wife trying to have a child, people trying to make wishes come true. Yeah. And they do. Everybody gets their wish. And then act, all hell breaks loose.
Yes, that's right. One gets their wish apart from the people who get maimed or died.
Yes.
Basically. So Little Red Riding Hood's in there. Jack and the Beanstalk
exactly.
is in there. The woods... Where are the woods, by the way? These woods of which we speak? Are they English woods?
They are English woods. In fact, some of them were built on a soundstage at Shepperton, the biggest soundstage I've ever seen. It was, and I remember walking in and thinking, oh, they've overdone these trees. I mean, I know it's a fantasy, but come on, nobody's going to. But then we went out into Windsor Forest, and there were the trees. They had just replicated these amazing, amazing woods, and we climbed in them, and we shot in them, and then they were replicated inside the studio. So, yes, they exist.
So they're English woods, and most of the cast sort of speak with an English accent, apart from Red Riding Hood and Cinderella.
And Johnny Depp.
Well,
and
he's
me.
Kind of being, they're kind of versions.
And the other prince, and Chris Pine. Well, he sort of does a plummy, I don't know what, mid-Atlantic something.
Yeah. Well, and we'll talk about the princes in just a moment. But the woods, what do the woods, what do they represent? Because there's a lot of, We spend very little time in the village, and everything is in the woods. Do they signify anything?
I'm sure they do. I'm sure it's the crucible everybody goes into in life, and you go on a quest and you meet all sorts of tests and trials in order to make your happy ending come true. And sometimes you get what you wish for, and sometimes it isn't exactly what you thought it would be.
And you are a fabulous witch. You're playing a witch again, and there must be some great joy to be had in becoming a hag.
Thank you very much.
I'm not quite sure I should have said that.
If that was successfully done on my part.
And the way you appear and the way you depart in the first act particularly is something to behold. You know, there are many times in this movie I felt like standing up and applauding.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, it's interestingly, Rob Marshall, who's the splendid director, who directed Chicago, lots of things, his idea was that this would be fantasy, but he didn't want to overload it with CGI, first of all, because we didn't have the money to do it, but also...
That's because Ken Branagh had spent it all.
He'd spent it all, and we'll see how that turns out. But he just wanted it to be wrought by hand, sort of human-sized, and not manipulated in some lab. And so... There are very few special effects, but it's magical, even so. And so my transformation, which in many other hands could have been wrought, you know, sort of artificially, was the witch, the old witch turns into, gets her wish, and she gets to look like she'd been done in a Hollywood makeup and hair department.
But you're quite an insecure witch. As well.
Yes.
I mean, you've got some evil powers, but you're not very sure of yourself, particularly when it comes... I mean, one of the themes, obviously, of the play and of this film is parenting and that mother-child relationship and abandonment. And
Well, everybody's unhappy on some level going into the woods, and they're trying to solve that problem. And she, the witch, wants her child to stay with her and to love her. And so everything that she sets in motion in this elaborate sort of plot is so that she'll get her wish and she'll be beautiful again and her daughter won't be, she'll undo the curse that was placed on her by her mother. And so there are lots of, themes that resonate in real life through these fairy tales, just as the fairy tales often... expressed anxieties of another age, you know, of an older time when they were cautionary tales.
But the good people in this story do bad things and lie and make stuff up. Mm. And you, as the witch, you have a line in which you say, and I wrote it down in a scrawly hand because it was dark in the screening room. You say, "I'm not good. I'm not nice. I'm just right."
Yes. Yes.
I actually thought at that moment of Mrs. Thatcher, and I wondered if actually that was a line that almost she could have said.
It's a line I could have said. Sometimes, you know, when you just feel the correctness of your position and you can't get it through the heads of the people because of how it's presented.
It's a good line.
Yeah, it's a great line.
Now, there is you've been involved with musicals all your life, but I would think there's acting and there's singing and there's musicals, but there's singing Sondheim, which is something else altogether.
Yes. Sondheim, it's so glorious to sing this music because it's like a little complete acting moment. Each story, each song has a narrative and a sort of a full life, meaning that it has not only lots of songs have emotion and they express one thing, but Sondheim always expresses conflict, two things at once. He has the contradictory truth embedded in also in the yearning. And so, yes, he's interested in complexity and in the mess of life and in nuance. And And so for an actor, that's just glorious to express.
And are they delightful to sing? Because from someone who can't sing a note, it sounds enormously complex and very tricky.
It's I wouldn't say tricky. It's a thoroughgoing thrill. I never tired of hearing this music. You know, we would go into the... Usually you go into making a film on a soundstage and you sort of make the magic up for yourself in your head. And a year later you come back and see the movie and it's been scored and there's music underlying and pulling emotion where it wants to go. But for us, music suffused our day. We went into the studio in the morning and the music, this great orchestra surrounded us all the time. There's music all through this, and so we felt like we were already in a movie. It was already sort of there. The world was created, and we just surfed that wave of splendid sound.
And I was sitting there trying to work out whether you're lip-syncing or whether you're singing live.
We were doing both, always. And so in the mix, eventually they used quite a bit of what we sang live, and other times where they were outside in the waterfall or airplanes were going over Windsor Forest, they used what we had pre-recorded. But yes, we always sang to ourselves.
Ken Branagh would have stopped the planes. He would have picked up the phone to the Queen.
He had the money, didn't he?
Yeah, he'd have got the Queen to sort that out. Well, I think people who aren't particularly in love with musicals will go and see Into the... I don't understand the people who are saying it's an 80s musical. Why is it happening now? Because to me, it was just it's a New Year delight. You know, from start to finish, you go in and you're immediately immersed in this really strange world. And it's terrific fun and enormously entertaining. And to see two princes, Chris Pine and Billy Magnussen, yeah. Basically they're the love interest. Let's reduce them. We hardly care about them, but they're funny.
They're the self-love interest.
That's very true. It's like a Spandau Ballet video from yes. From 1982. Yeah. It's terrific fun.
Oh,
and you're singing in your next film.
Yes, but a different kind of singing. If Sondheim was heaven, that sort of rock and roll hell.
This is the Jonathan Demme film, Ricky and the Flash.
Yeah, Ricky and the Flash. And it's about a woman who moves from her life in Indiana to fulfill a dream in Hollywood of being a rock and roll singer. And time's gone by and it hasn't happened. And the San Fernando Valley is filled with people who had that big dream and are now singing cover songs in bars, and that's who this is. But I have a great band.
Another great, it's a great orchestra and a great band. And yeah. I just want to mention you've worked with another Abby Morgan script. Again with playing in Suffragette.
Oh, thank you for mentioning Suffragette. I just have seen an assemblage of it. I mean, it's not.
And you're
not
Emily Pankhurst, yeah.
Yeah, with Carey Mulligan and Sarah Gavron has directed it, and it's just, I think it'll be shocking for people. They don't know how recently the world was different for women in England and in the world. It's just an amazing piece that she's put together. Shocking.
And do you think your witch is going to win more awards?
My witch?
Yeah.
I've won the approval of my children, which is basically what I dream of.
I think you're going to have some more acceptance speeches just ready, Meryl.
Bless you. Thanks.
Meryl Streep, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.